Majority of members present, I declare the motion passed. Promotion of Recycling and Proper Disposal Product Container Amendment Bill 2015.
Council resumes. Companies winding up in Miscellaneous Provisions Amendment Bill 2015. Second reading debate. Mr. Wong Ting-kwong, Chairman of the Bills Committee on the above bill, will address the Council on the Committee's report. Mr. Wong Ting-kwong. Thank you, Mr. President. The Chairman of the Bills Committee on Companies Winding Up and Miscellaneous Provisions Amendment Bill 2015, I table into the Council the report of the Bills Committee and report on the work of the Bills Committee. The bill seeks to amend the Companies Winding Up and Miscellaneous Provisions Ordinance, or the ordinance and the subsidiary legislation, to increase protection of creditors, streamline the winding up process, and further enhance the integrity of the process. The Bills Committee has held 8 meetings to study the bill with the administration, including 1 meeting to receive views from deputations. The Bills Committee supports the major proposals in the bill. On increasing the protection for creditors, Clauses 88 to 90 provide that the court may exercise discretion to set aside transactions at an undervalue entered into by the company within 5 years before the commencement of the winding up. The Bills Committee is concerned whether this would affect normal business transactions. The administration has explained that the proposal of transaction at an undervalue is to ensure that the company's assets will not be inappropriately disposed of or transferred prior to its winding up, and to preserve as far as possible the company's assets available for distribution to creditors. The relevant provisions will not affect genuine business transactions. Some deputations are concerned that if a company boosts sales by dumping prices prior to its winding up, and if such transactions are regarded as transactions at an undervalue by the court, whether commission payments earned by employees from such transactions of the company would be caught. The administration has expressed that the employee's commission is generally calculated according to employment contracts or company policies, rather than as part of a transaction between a company and a third party. Under normal circumstances, the commission payments made to the employees will not be affected. The bill also strengthens the protection measures for director-initiated creditors' voluntary winding up under existing Section 228A of the ordinance. The Bills Committee has examined how the proposed safeguards can reduce the risk of abuse by directors. The administration has explained that the proposed amendments require that the company's meeting must have been summoned and a professional liquidator must have been appointed before the commencement of the winding up. The new 228B provides that, with a few specified exceptions, the provisional liquidator may exercise powers conferred on a liquidator only after obtaining the sanction of the court. If a director or the appointed provisional liquidator, without reasonable excuse, fails to comply with the requirements, he or she will be liable to a fine. The bill amends Section 241 to prescribe a minimum notice period of 7 days for calling the first creditors' meeting, and requires that the first creditors' meeting shall be held within 14 days after the holding of the company's meeting in which the resolution for voluntary winding up is proposed. The Bills Committee is concerned that the potential time gap of 14 days may create a period of uncertainty on the position of the appointed liquidator, and may lead to potential abuse of powers by directors. The administration has advised that existing provisions in the ordinance do not specify a minimum period of notice required for calling the first creditors' meeting. The proposed amendments are to ensure reasonably sufficient notice period for creditors to prepare for the first creditors' meeting and to make informed decisions. The bill already set out adequate protection measures. The proposed 243A and 250A will be imposing appropriate restrictions on the powers of liquidators and directors. If a liquidator or director, without reasonable excuse, fails to comply with the relevant requirements, then he or she will be liable to a fine. On streamlining the winding up process, the new Section 207B allows members of a committee of inspection, COI, to attend meetings remotely, that is, using technology to enable members not present together at the same place to attend the meeting. Some members are of the view that COI meetings are very important for creditors. As such, there should be requirements for using remote attendance to ensure that COI meetings would be conducted in a prudent manner. The administration has explained that allowing COI members to attend a meeting remotely can facilitate the operation of COI meetings, members' participation in meetings, and save time and costs for holding and attending COI meetings. It may complicate the provisions if further preconditions are to be prescribed for using remote attendance for COI meetings. The Bills Committee considers that the relevant provisions in the bill have not clearly reflected the remote attendance arrangements. Members also agree that the provisions shall clearly stipulate that COI members may choose to attend the meeting at the specified place if they do not want to attend the meeting remotely. According to the administration, the new Section 207B bracket 8 provides that any COI member may request a liquidator to specify the place of meeting in accordance with Section 207C, and the liquidator must comply with the request. Under such circumstances, the COI members may choose to attend the meeting at a specified time, a place, and join the meeting by remote attendance. Having considered the BC's views, the administration has agreed to move a CSA to the new sections 207B8 to clarify the arrangements. The new section 207A provides that a COI member can authorize a person to represent him or her in the COI. So, the section provides that the letter of authority should be signed by or on behalf of the member. To prevent abuse, the Bills Committee has requested the administration to consider implementing appropriate restrictions. The administration has agreed to move a committee stage amendment to amend Section 207A bracket 2, bracket B, bracket 2, to the effect that if the COI member is a natural person, the letter of authority must be signed by the member. And for other cases, such as when the COI member is a body corporate, the letter of authority may be signed by or on behalf of the relevant COI member. The proposed rule 176 subrule 2 of the company's winding up rules allows the bills of cost or charges of a person employed by official receiver or the liquidator in a court winding up to be approved by COI by resolution instead of taxation by the court as currently required. The Bills Committee notes that some deputations have reservation about the proposal as they are concerned about whether COI members, such as SME creditors, are capable of determining the reasonable cost and charges for the liquidator's agents. The administration has responded that the proposal seeks to provide court-free procedures which will in turn reduce the cost and time for administering winding up cases. During the public consultation exercise in 2013, the majority of the submissions received were supportive of the proposal. The administration has stressed that if the COI does not agree with the proposed fees charged by the liquidator's agents, it may refuse to approve the fees. If the liquidator is unable to reach an agreement with the COI, the liquidator is required to make use of the existing mechanism to seek court's determination on the matter. The bill proposes to improve the private and public examination procedures in the winding up regime to enhance regulation. The Bills Committee notes that under the existing sections 168IA and section 222, the examinee will be provided with a copy of the report submitted to the court by the official receiver or liquidator before attending the public examination. However, the proposed amendments to 168IA and the new section 286A remove this right. The Bills Committee notes that if a copy of the report is not provided to the examinee, he would be deprived of the opportunity of knowing the case against him so as to obtain legal advice before attending the public examination. The administration has explained that the report to the court has to be kept confidential, or it may adversely affect the effectiveness of the examination. The administration has also clarified that the purpose of a public examination is to gather more information on the company being wound up and not to seek the court's determination or to impose any control or take any enforcement action against the examinee. Protection has been offered to the examinee in the public examination. The new Rule 51 capital A 2 provides that the examinee may apply to the court to see all or part of the report. The existing Rule 54 of the company winding up rules also provide that the official receiver or the liquidator is required to give a notice to attend the public examination to the examinee, in which relevant matters will be set out. The examinee may seek legal advice on matters relating to the public examination before attending the examination. The Bills Committee has also deliberated on issues relating to the bill. Some members are concerned that the bill has not addressed the issue of the long time gap between the commencement of the winding up process of a company and provision of ex gratia payments to employees from PWIF. They've urged the administration to explore possible measures to streamline and expedite the process of payment from PWIF, protection against of wages against insolvency fund. In response to members' concerns about the PWIF process, the Financial Services and the Treasury Bureau has followed up the issue with the Labour and Welfare Bureau and the Labour Department. The Labour Department should review its procedures of verifying and calculating the extra ex gratia payments so as to expedite the grant of payments, and also to explore further measures to assist eligible employees in winding up cases to apply for PWIF. Some members of the Bills Committee are of the view that the administration should take the opportunity of the bill to raise the maximum amount stipulated in Section 265 of the Ordinance on preferential payments to employees to bring the amount in line with the levels of ex gratia payments payable to employees under PWIO. They have pointed out that there has been no review of the caps under 265 for years, and increasing the caps would benefit employees. The administration has clarified that for employees who are paid ex gratia payments from PWIF, their beneficial interest will not be affected by the caps under Section 265, since the wages and other payment items owed to them will first be paid from PWIF, subject to the maximum amounts on respective items under the PWIF. On the other hand, because the PWIO provides that PWIF has subrogation rights to recover the amount of ex gratia payments made to applicants, increasing the caps under Section 265 in such circumstances will result in the transfer of PWIF a larger amount of money received from the realization of the assets of a company being wound up. As a result, increasing the existing caps under Section 265 will not enhance the rights of employees. On the contrary, it will create unfavorable impact on other creditors. The stakeholders are of the view that the caps under Section 265 should not be increased at this stage. The Bills Committee supports resumption of second reading of the bill and has no objection to the administration's CSAs. The details are set out in the Bills Committee's report. The Bills Committee will not move any amendment. Mr. President, on behalf of the DAB, I'd like to give our take on the bill. The bill seeks to enhance the corporate winding up regime so that through streamlining the winding up procedure, costs can be saved, and also to increase regulation of liquidators and provisional liquidators so that the whole regime can be improved and can be kept up with the times and to be aligned with international standards. This will instill confidence in investors and also increase protection for creditors. In the long term, it will also bolster Hong Kong's status as the international financial and commercial center. The DAB supports the bill as it increases protection for creditors. As for the amendments, the DAB also supports them. In the scrutiny of the bill, well, some members are concerned about the certain arrangements in the bill. They believe the arrangements are unclear, and as I said in my report, for example, COI members will be allowed to attend meetings remotely in the bill. And according to some members, if the COI members do not wish to attend meetings remotely, the COI members could specify the place of meeting. And also in the bill, it is proposed that the COI members can sign the letter of authority, or somebody on his behalf may sign this letter of authority. And some members are concerned whether this system will be abused. And also in relation to public examination, the bill proposes that the examinee will not be given a copy of the report prepared by the official receiver or the liquidator. And some members believe that this is unfair to the examinee in question. Noting members' concerns, the administration has agreed to move amendments. So as to clarify the arrangements and to allay our concerns, the DAB therefore supports the administration's amendments. Now, the views of the members of the Bills Committee are already explained in my report to the Council just now, and their concerns expressed during the scrutiny of the bill. So I won't repeat the points. I just want to point out that this bill involves a number of technical and procedural amendments, and members and stakeholders have already expressed concerns over some practical arrangements in the bill. For example, in the bill, before commencement of the winding up of the company, or 5 years before the commencement of the winding up, the court is empowered to set aside the transactions entered into by the company at an undervalue, so as to avoid the assets distributable to creditors to be reduced. Now, some deputations are concerned about the 5-year clawback period and the definition of transactions at an undervalue. For example, some companies may boost sales by dumping prices before the winding up, and there is a concern whether the commission payments earned by employees before the winding up will be regarded as transactions at an undervalue, and whether employees will be asked to repay the commissions earned. And there are deputations which questioned about the 5-year clawback period. They believe that it is too long. And also, there are questions on whether this is enforceable, as after the transactions, the goods will have been delivered. According to the administration, if in entering into a transaction with a company, the consideration paid by another party is not substantially lower than the price of or the cost of the goods, and that it is a genuine business transaction without impacting on the company's interest, then it is not a transaction at an undervalue. Employees' commission is not part of a transaction between a company and a third party, so it would not be caught. As for the 5-year clawback period, It is in line with the clawback period for under the bankruptcy ordinance. So I hope that the administration can explain in detail the new arrangements to the relevant stakeholders and also to heed their views on difficulties in implementing the new arrangements, review the effectiveness of the new initiatives, and to ensure that these initiatives are effective. During scrutiny of the bill, members representing the labor sector and labor unions have made further suggestions on further increasing the protection for employees. But this is not really within the scope of the bill. For example, they would like the administration to expedite the process in granting extra share payments under the PWIF to employees. For example, the employees should be able to apply for extra share payments from PWIF directly without going through the Labor Department, because for some non-grassroots employees, when they petition to the court for winding up of the company, they are not eligible for legal aid and they have to pay the litigation costs. But in the end, the litigation costs are so huge that they can't really recover any amount. And also another another view is that Section 265 is out of date, and the cap or the maximum amount payable to employees under the PWIF should be set so that it is consistent with the maximum amount payable to employees under PWIF. And also for employees, they should be given a higher priority over other unsecured creditors in the event of the company being wound up. But I don't think this is within the scope of the bill. Further consultation should be carried out. The stakeholders' views should be sought, and the administration should in the future follow up on this issue. I so submit, Mr. President, I support the bill and the amendments.
Thank you, Mr. President. I speak as a member of the Companies Winding Up and Miscellaneous Provision Amendment Bill, both committee member. I'm in support of the resumption of the second reading of the bill and the third reading of the bill, and also the government's proposed committee stage amendment. In fact, this bill updated and provides certain amendments so that our laws would be in line with the international practice. In particular, the new provisions on transactions at an undervalue and unfair preferences, are indeed timely changes. But Mr. President, I do have a few concerns about the present bill, and also I would like to remind the government there are dire gaps in the area of law regarding insolvency and liquidation in Hong Kong, which I do believe the government would have a responsibility to fill in these gaps. Now, first of all, I would like to draw to the attention that there is currently no registration or licensing system for a practitioner who practices insolvency law. Now, this issue has been raised by many professionals for quite a number of years, and I think the attitude of the official receiver's office and also of the government has been wavering from one side. Yes, sometimes they do agree that, yes, we need to consider whether there should be a licensing system. And on the other hand, after a few years, they say no, because they want to keep their system nice and simple. But I couldn't see the reason why, because as the liquidation process becoming more complicated, and as the law changes so quickly, a basic professional requirement should be required for all people practicing in liquidation. Now, at present, the professionals who are doing the liquidation process will range from some accountants or lawyers who have some post-qualification studies in this area. But also, there are instances in some liquidation that these are done by amateur people. And I do hope that Hong Kong can catch up with other jurisdictions like Singapore or even some of the offshore jurisdictions and Cayman Islands. We need to maintain a list of licensed liquidation practitioners. And we do need these people to have the basic qualification and experience to do the job. Come an economic downturn, you will see the number of liquidation and insolvency will go up. And if we wait for a couple of years, we will lose our competitive edge. We are not catching up with the international standard. And next, there is also a big gap in our corporate rescue or insolvency trading law. Sometimes the situation is not as dire as going to strict to liquidate a company instantaneously. Sometimes there may be instances that a company could be rescued, the debt could be restructured and written off. And in fact, Hong Kong does not have a corporate rescue law. It is my long-standing support for the introduction of a statutory corporate rescue procedure and insolvent trading provision. I believe that there is a significant gap in the corporate insolvency law of Hong Kong, and this should be the next priority of the government to fill in this gap. Now, the next gap I have identified in this piece of legislation is that the Hong Kong corporate insolvency law, there is a lack of framework for cross-border cooperation on insolvency matter. Now, this is becoming increasingly clear in the light of the multi-jurisdictional nature of many larger insolvency cases. And the Hong Kong court has already made known its concern about this. In my view, the implementation of the United Nations Commission on International Trade Law, Model Law, as part of the company's winding up and miscellaneous provisions ordinance, would facilitate insolvency and restructuring procedures relating to Hong Kong companies with assets overseas and overseas companies with assets in Hong Kong. Indeed, legislation based on the model law has been adopted in a number of jurisdictions, including the US, the UK, Australia, New Zealand, Canada, Japan, and South Africa. Indeed, there are express provisions in the mainland's enterprise bankruptcy law to deal with cross-border aspects of insolvency cases. Another example I have to quote is Section 426 of the UK's Insolvency Act, which gives recognition to cooperation between courts in other countries or territories exercising jurisdiction in relation to insolvency. These are the gaps, but there remains one big concern about the present bill. The big concern is the proposed Section 276, which extends the personal liabilities of liquidators in court order winding ups under certain circumstances, even if a liquidator is being released. In certain circumstances, the liabilities remain with the liquidator if they have committed some fraudulent act, etc. And this liability could remain even after they have left the profession and become and take up another profession or become a layman. And I do believe that For this reason, it is a deterrent to debar, it's a deterrent to prohibit more people from taking up the insolvency practice as a profession. And I do hope in the next round of the updating of the insolvency law, I do hope the government should take some time and study this particular provision in light of the concern of the profession. Thank you, Mr. President.
Does any other member wish to speak?
Thank you, Mr. President. The Civic Party supports the passage of the bill. I think, Mr. President, you understand that in order to instill confidence in investors and creditors of a company, an effective winding up regime is important. Now, in Hong Kong, Mr. President, you will know that there are different winding up arrangements. The first one is a court winding up situation, that is, a court-ordered winding up of a company. And there are also other common cases of winding up of companies, one being creditors' voluntary winding up, and the other being members' voluntary winding up, and that is members or directors of the company. And there is, in fact, also another kind, which is less common on the basis of the financial situation of the company. Directors of the company can also initiate a winding up process with the consent of creditors. For these types of winding up cases, very often before the company is wound up, if shareholders or creditors of the company, or rather directors of the company, can exploit the time gap before the winding up order is handed down to dissipate the assets distributable to creditors. In short, they can do something to realize the assets belonging to the company. In a way that ordinary creditors can never lay hands on. All along, even without this bill, the courts in Hong Kong will rely on the common law and or equitable or the law of equity to help creditors recover these assets or to restore. The assets of the company or have the assets of the company plowed back to the pool of capital, so to speak, of the company to be distributed to creditors. But this is not systematic, and there is no codification of the common law principles and equity principles for the courts to exercise these powers to ensure that ordinary creditors or members or shareholders of a company can be given more protection. In particular, on the point of transactions at an undervalue, proceeds from a transaction entered into by a company should be able to be distributed to creditors.
變得無效，然後將嗰啲資產咧擠翻落去公司嘅資產裏頭咧，其實呢一個
such transactions as an undervalue should be voided, and the proceeds plowed back for distribution to creditors. And this is one step forward. Now, in relation to the company's winding up a miscellaneous provisions amendment bill 2015, in relation to transactions at an undervalue entered into by a company, and the court's powers in setting aside these transactions are now consistent with Section 6 of the Bankruptcy Ordinance. And this is, again, an improvement, because for bankruptcy law applicable to individuals and the winding up law for companies, there should not be any substantial inconsistency on the matter of transactions at an undervalue. Although these two different regimes, they involve transactions at an undervalue so as to conceal assets distributable to creditors. And now these, arrangement under the two regimes are aligned, and this is an improvement. The Civic Party is of the view that in the winding up process, under the bill, more protection is given to creditors as well as shareholders or members of a company and investors. We hope that with the passage of the bill, in the event of a company being wound up, more creditors and investors can be offered enhanced protection. And Hong Kong is an important business, international business center. And we hope that our corporate winding up regime can instill confidence in investors around the world. I so submit, Mr. President, I support the bill.
Does any other member wish to speak? Ms. Chen Yun-han. Thank you. I support the bill, but it's unfortunate that you have not gone far enough. You have talked about improving and expediting the winding up process. We have nothing to say about that. But winding up would involve a very important sector, and those are the employees. When a company goes into liquidation, employees would be one of the first victims because they would lose their job, they can see no prospect, they are not paid, they have no money to pay rent, to buy baby formula, and some of them might have not been paid wages for a few months before winding up. And we know that very often these employees will have to go to the Labor Department and many other departments of the government in order to tackle the difficulty. Now, if that's the case, why don't you go
further. And that is why Mr. Wong Ting-kwong also mentioned the view of labor organizations. We had hoped that the bill would take up all these issues, but it's unfortunate that the bill only covers a small area. The bill will be necessary, but what about the employees involved in a winding up situation? I think the FSTB should also look at it. Well, you may say this belongs to the LW Bureau, but a responsible government should work together to resolve these problems. Therefore, when we knew that there could be amendments, well, at the beginning, many labor organizations were very excited. They thought that the bill would cover the other sector of people affected by winding up, but we are disappointed because this is not taken up in the bill. I don't know whether the administration doesn't know about this or there is no communication between bureaus. Mr. Matthew Cheung has to face up to such situations every time. Every time there is a winding up, the employees would go to him and we would like employees to be paid arrears in wages from the Protection of Wages and Insolvency Fund. I have worked with the labor sector for so many years and I really feel very deeply about this. Last year there was the DSC winding up and this year we are tackling another major case. The boss absconded and you may subject the company to liquidation. It's just that many years ago we dealt with Yaohan, the Japanese department store, and then after liquidation we can get money paid out of the PWIP. But now the boss has absconded and the case is stayed and the employees are left to fend for themselves. I'd like to really ask, why don't you also take up this point? If the boss has not admitted that he is insolvent, then the personnel departments or departments of the company should work together with government. And this is a case of insolvency. We really need to do this. But then the administration has not attended to this issue in this bill. There are over 400 employees and they were running from one department to another. They went to the Customs and Excise Department and then they went to another department, one after another. And the LW Bureau and the Labor Department could only stand there and stare at us. We tried to make them do something and they would do a little something for us. But those who are very experienced in helping the labor force, well, would know how to go about it, this. But we can't expect the average employee to know what to do in such a situation. With our efforts, with noises being made, the PWIF paid out wages in just 2 months in the DSC case. But then in many other cases, we don't get wages paid out of PWIF. In fact, if the liquidation is done and if all the conditions are satisfied, wages can be paid out very soon. But then departments are passing the buck to one another. Say if the boss admits that he is insolvent, then it should be up to the labor department or one bureau to take care of the issue. But now this is not done. The employees would have to chase up the boss. What if the boss has absconded and then you have to go through the labor tribunal and the presiding officer would have to make a judgment, but then the presiding officer would have to ask the LW Bureau for information and also to look into the accounts of the company. I think starting from the 80s, 90s, I have been dealing with these bankruptcy cases, and we have told the administration that it has to deal with these problems. I remember with the Yaohan case, there was another director of labor. And then it was just a month or so into the case that the PWIF was activated. It is because we could take the step of making sure that the boss is insolvent, but sometimes the boss has just absconded. Therefore, it's just like the offsetting mechanism, Mr. Secretary. I don't know whether you or the LW Bureau should be responsible, but then you have to work together to resolve these problems. Very often, conflicts in society do not have to be resolved through protests and marches.
But then you can just tackle the facts. When the boss is purely insolvent, why don't you just go to PWIF instead of going through the labor tribunal? You can speed up the process if you want to. I really feel deeply about this, Mr. President. Mr. Wang Ting-kwong understands us, and we have been pursuing this matter because this is so hard to come by. We have this bill which is called Companies Winding Up and Miscellaneous Provisions, Amendment Bill 2015. We started in the 70s, and the administration really has to do something about this. Moreover, I know that we cannot move amendments, but then you have the priority payment clause. Now, by priority, it means you stand in line, the insolvency order is issued, and then you have to stand in line for distribution of the remaining assets. And it is good. Now, employees will stand in the third place. The first one is administration and two, that is to deal with immovable assets, and then the employees would come third. But then if the wages of arrears is $8,000, and then the LP and LSP, that would at most be $8,000. But these figures were set 30, 40 years ago. You should update the figures now. The administration may say, okay, you go to PWIF, and if there is money in the PWIF, you will be paid a sum, and then if there are remaining assets, that would be distributed. But it shouldn't be like that. The main purpose of the PWIF is to pay wages by a certain or good enough percentage so that the workers have subsistence during unemployment. But the administration has not heeded our view. It has been a few decades, and inflation has climbed. You should really update these figures. Well, I support the bill because it improves the winding up process by streamlining the administrative procedures, but that is done from the angle of the bosses or employers. It's unfortunate and pitiful that you have not dealt with the welfare of workers. I hope that Mr. Chan, after you have heard me today, if you're interested, there are cases which are still being dealt with, and people have waited a long time and they cannot get wages from the PWIF. It is because the Labor Department has passed the cases to the Labor Tribunal, but the Tribunal will have to look at the accounts of the relevant companies, and they have to do a lot of checking and verification. In fact, the Labor Department has already done it. They have teams to verify the figures, but then the Labor Department doesn't want to take up the cases, and they send the cases to the Labor Tribunal. Why are you doing that? Because you have used public money to check all the figures. You owe one $3,000, you owe two $2,000, and in fact, the Labor Department has all the powers. After checking the figures, it can activate the PWIF, but then the Labor Department wants to protect itself. You have to think about the welfare of the workers. What do you expect them to do? Why do you make them wait half a year or even longer by passing the cases to the Labor Tribunal? Mr. Chairman, of course you know this. Many members would know this. Workers would, of course, sometimes argue with the accounts. They may say, you don't owe me $1 but $2. And you have to separate cases with no dispute and cases with some disputes. But Mr. Wang Ting-kwong, you know, they lump them together. Those that are not subject of arguments should directly be passed to the PWIF. But no, they are asking everybody to wait. I have been complaining time and again, but then the directors of labor did not listen to us. Why do you want to put all the cases together, and why do you make people wait even if there is no dispute? Very often, the fastest is 2.5 months. But then you say you want to work for the welfare of the people, but it's not what you are doing. I have witnessed many bankruptcy cases. It's really very difficult. The workers don't know whether they should land another job because they always have to attend tribunal hearings. And then they ask me, they would say, okay, I will not pursue the wages, but still it's my money, it's my wages. I'm telling the administration, you should not drag the cases on because the workers have to get subsistence. They need to continue a living. But then you ask them to go to the labor's tribunal and then the legal aid department. You are talking about people who have suddenly lost their jobs. We set up the PWIF because of the plight of workers in bankruptcy cases. And then it was resolved between the employers and employees so that the PWIF can solve the urgent needs of workers. But the administration is really very bureaucratic. You can separate the two queues, can't you? And those without disputes should be paid out immediately. I have dealt with numerous PWIF cases, and I am really given the impetus because of the difficulties involved to further help workers. The workers already lose their jobs. They don't know about the processes, so they have to wait long and hard for the wages. Mr. President, I thank you for not saying that I have digressed. I will emphasize again, I have not digressed. It is just that when you have this winding up bill, you have chosen to forget the employees. Secretary, I said many times at the Bills Committee, I said many, many times already, but unfortunately, I was stonewalled. Here, I am speaking to you again. I hope you are hearing me. We are very happy to have further discussions with you if you have issues that you like to ask us, especially when the economy is going on a downside trend. You really have to understand the helplessness of the workers. They are passed from one department to another, from one organization to another. I hope this bill will be further amended so that workers' welfare will also be attended to. Thank you.
Does any other member wish to speak? If not, I call upon the Secretary for FST to reply.
SFST. Mr. President, first I'd like to thank wholeheartedly the Chairman, Mr. Wong Ting-kwong, and members of the Bills Committee on Companies Winding Up and Miscellaneous Provisions Amendment Bill 2015. I also need to thank the Secretariat and the Legal Advisor for the Bills Committee and the hard efforts they made so that there is smooth completion of the scrutiny of the bill. I have also to thank deputations and individuals who made representations to the Bills Committee. After submitting the bill to the Legislative Council in October 2015, the Bills Committee held 8 meetings. We have considered views received in the process of scrutiny, and also we have scrutinized again the provisions of the bill. We are now submitting some CSAs in order to further clarify the meaning and objectives of the bill. We have also submitted some drafting or technical amendments. I will be moving them in the committee stage. The policy objective of the bill is to give more protection to creditors, to streamline the winding up procedure, and also to have a more comprehensive winding up procedure. An effective winding up system will make sure that the remaining assets of an insolvent company will be preserved as far as possible so that these assets will be distributed among the creditors of the company in a fair and orderly manner in winding up. And I'm including the employees, suppliers, and also the contractors of the company. The bill puts forward many proposals to improve Hong Kong's winding up process so that it is modernized and would be more in line with the latest international developments so as to give protection and confidence to investors and creditors, and also to improve Hong Kong's business environment. In protecting creditors, the main proposals are: one, with regard to transactions at an undervalue entered into in the 5 years before liquidation, the court is empowered to set aside such transactions. Transactions at an undervalue mean that the company enters into a transaction for a consideration the value of which is significantly less than the value of the consideration provided by the company, or it receives no consideration for such transactions. The purpose is to make sure that the assets of the company will not be inappropriately disposed of or transferred before liquidation, and to preserve assets that can be distributed to creditors. As for the 5-year clawback period, we have taken reference from the personal bankruptcy laws. With regard to the provisions on transactions and an undervalue in the bill, there will not be any impact on genuine business transactions. Number two, the ordinance already empowers the court to void unfair preferences in the liquidation process. But then this is only done by way of mention, and this is in relation to the unfair preferences with regard to the bankruptcy ordinance governing personal bankruptcy. So it is not entirely proper for this to be applied to company liquidation situations. The bill includes an individual provision on unfair preference so as to clarify matters. Number three, in voluntary liquidation, before the holding of the first creditors' meeting, the directors and members of the liquidated company might already appoint provisional liquidators or liquidators. Now, we put in extra measures to limit the powers of provisional liquidators or liquidators so that the processes will not be abused. In streamlining liquidation processes, the bill puts forward many measures in order to improve the procedures of the Committee on Inquiry, including reducing court processes and also to streamline other processes. The main proposals are: one, in court winding up cases, it is proposed that the bills of costs or charges for liquidators' agents can be approved by the COI. And after approval is given, it does not need to be taxed by the court as at present. In the discussion of the Bills Committee, we pointed out that this is an alternative so as to save the time and costs required if there is taxation by the court. If the COI members cannot reach an agreement with the liquidator will still have to decide on the bill of costs or charges according to present procedures. In the discussion of the Bills Committee, we also pointed out that in court liquidation cases, since the liquidator can always engage lawyers to assist the cases, but then liquidators would also have to first get the approval of the COI or the court. Therefore, we think there is room for streamlining of the present procedure. The bill proposes that the liquidator can give advance notice of 7 days to the COI in order to exercise the powers to engage a lawyer to help discharge the duties of a liquidator, instead of what is required now, and that is to first get the approval of the COI or the court. If any creditor is not happy with the powers of the liquidators in engaging a lawyer, he can object to the court according to the present ordinance. Number three, to allow COI to adopt technology to go about its work, including that the liquidator can communicate with members electronically, and members can have remote attendance at meetings, and also members can also provide or submit resolutions electronically. In the meeting of the BC, we explained to members who had concerns about the remote attendance of members at the COI. With regard to further improving on the winding up processes, the main proposals are: after liquidators have dealt with liquidation cases and it has applied to the court the discharge of the duty, approved parties can still apply to the court to ask the court to order that the liquidator will still have to take up legal liability because of misfeasance, breach of duty, or breach of trust committed by the liquidator. Some members of the sector have shown concern about this, and we explained to the Bills Committee the importance of the proposed provision in terms of protecting creditors. And for other professions in Hong Kong, they also have to take up similar legal liabilities. The proposed provision will also provide appropriate protection for the liquid data, because anyone will have to get approval by the court before it can target the legal liability to be taken up by liquidators. Number two, there are new disclosure stipulations to state that prospective provisional liquidators or prospective liquidators will have to disclose the specified relationship between himself and his family with the liquidated company. This will enhance the transparency of the appointment process and also make sure that the creditors will make an informed appointment decision. Number three, we expand the types of people who are ineligible to be appointed to be provisional liquidators or liquidators so that we can also include people with potential conflicts of interest. Some members said that the administration should come up with statutory corporate rescue procedures as soon as possible. We are working on it so that we can set up new corporate rescue processes, and that is that the that is to do with trading in insolvency. The legislative proposal has been supported by the relevant panel and other stakeholders. We are now drafting the drafting instructions to amend the relevant law, and we will be consulting stakeholders on the details. We expect to submit the amendment bill to LegCo in 2017-2018. Some members, including Ms. Chen Yun Han, mentioned that the administration should expedite the processes for PWIF. We have already reflected the view to the LW Bureau and the Labor Department. The Labor Department has stated that it has noted that view. All in all, the bill puts forward different proposals to improve the winding up processes of Hong Kong. It will be modernized, and this will be particularly important in enhancing Hong Kong's business environment. If the bill is supported by the Legislative Council, we will mount public publicity as soon as possible and also come up with complementary arrangements administratively. For example, the official receiver's office will issue notices to the industry in order to introduce the relevant issues and would also make publicity through its website and publications. I hope members will support the bill and also CSAs to be moved later.
And I'll put the question to you, and that is that the company's winding up and miscellaneous provisions, Amendment Bill 2015, be read the second time. Will those in favour please raise their hands? Those against, please raise their hands. I think the question is agreed by majority of the members present. I declare the motion passed. Company's winding up and miscellaneous provisions, Amendment Bill 2015.